money. Come on now. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We welcome you to New Life Christian Fellowship. We're located at 1321 Providence Road in the city of Brandon, Florida. And we are so glad that you're watching with us on today. Amen.
Amen.
All right. I like when I get feedback. You know, feedback is always good. That means that somebody is listening to whatever it is that you're saying. Hallelujah. So this is the day that the Lord has made, a day in which we're to be glad in Him. Amen. This is the day that the Lord has made. I tell you, in the last couple of weeks, Bishop and I have been through a whirlwind. But praise ye the Lord, who always causes us to triumph in Him. Amen? God has been a keeper. When I say He's been a keeper, He has been a keeper. He has been so, so good to us. I can't even begin to express my gratitude towards this church and everything that everyone has done for us during this time of loss. You know, when you lose a child, it's so much different than when you lose a brother or a sister, even your mother or your father. There's just something about a child, especially when your child is of a young age and it's an unexpected death, and you know that child is full of life and you just finished speaking to them and they were happy and you was happy to hear from them, and then the next phone call that you get is that your child is no longer with us. So I just thank and praise God for everyone at New Life Christian Fellowship, because I know that you guys love us with an undying love. You have demonstrated it. When we went to New York, my sister-in-law, Sister Hopi Bays Reeve and her family, they just took such good care of us while we were there. My other sister-in-law, Vanessa Bogan, and her husband, Harold, they came all the way from Syracuse, New York, and they just blessed us abundantly. I mean, God, I mean, I was just seeing this God just moving and moving and moving. And then my other sister-in-law, Kim, that I haven't seen, and oh my God, so many years. It had been so many years since I had seen Kim, I forgot all about her. You know, and I felt so bad. I mean, how do you forget a family member, you know? But she's been away, we've been away, we've been doing different things, and such is life. But then the Lord pulled her in, and she was with us, and she was such a blessing as well. Amen. Rosalind, oh my God, did she not do a great job taking care of her brother? She did everything that needed to be taken care of in New York. We didn't have to worry about anything but just landing, getting there, getting to the hotel, getting situated, and showing up the day of the funeral. She was just amazing. And I just thank God that He gave Rosalind that strength as a twin sister, you know, after losing her brother that she loved dearly, to do all that she did. It was amazing. The funeral home, although some of you were able to watch, you weren't able to see, but it was packed to the brim. It was packed to the brim. Robert knew a lot of people in New York, and a lot of people loved him. And they came out and they showed their love, and it was just wonderful. I just want to give you a recap of everything and how wonderful. You know, Bishop may express it in his own words, but I want you to hear it from my heart, you know, and how I felt just being there and just seeing that our son was so loved, so, so loved. Every parent does not have the opportunity to share that testimony with others, you know? But Robert grew up in a loving home. He had a loving mother. He had loving aunts and uncles, a loving sister. Just love all around him he had from a child. His childhood was not easy. If you're born in the city of New York, around the time that he was born, and even up until now, it is not an easy place to grow up and live. But through it all, he went back home. That's where he wanted to be, and that's where the Lord took him home at. So I just want to just say thank you to all my family and my friends, my best friend Deborah in Gloucester, Virginia. You know, she's been a rock for me for over 50 years. And I just want to give her a shout out because I know that she is a true friend. I want to give a shout out to Mother V, who always remembers me. Always remembers me. She's an awesome woman of God. I want to also give out a shout to Joanne Stinyard, who immediately tried to get a hold of me and didn't stop till she got me and been a blessing to my life. And then there's just so many others, you know. If I don't call out your name, it's not because I don't want to. It's because it's just all of you are included in there. Every last one of you is all that I can say. So we're back. Bishop is back. Please continue to pray for us. We have our moments when we're doing really, really good. And then all of a sudden, we just like, okay, what's going on right now, you know? And I know that prayer works because prayer was what kept me and him while we were gone, took us there and brought us back. You know, on this morning, when I was doing my time of meditation with the Lord, a song came to my spirit, to my heart. And so I was trying to sing it, and I got some of it, and I couldn't remember the other parts of it. So I said, well, let me look it up. And the name of the song is Precious Jesus. And the words go like this. Precious Jesus, how I love you. How I lift high my voice with your praise. Holy Spirit, I implore thee, drench my heart as my lips part your praise. I am persuaded, Lord, to love you. I have been changed to bless your name. I am constrained by this great gospel, forever to worship thee, forever to worship thee. I am persuaded, precious Jesus, oh Lord, to love you, to love you, to love you, to love you until my last dying breath. Father, I just want to say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, because you have been wonderful. God, you have been great. You have shown your hand everywhere I turned and I looked. God, you have provided. Even when you didn't have to, Lord, you provided. I am persuaded, Lord, to love you. Because I know that you first loved me. So I am grateful and I am thankful on this morning to be back home, to stand before your people, to give you glory, to give you honor, to give you praise. Because, oh God, how I miss being in your house. I don't know how people can stay away from your house, God. Even under the circumstances, Lord, for we don't know the day or the hour of which the Son of Man will come to bring us to glory. So, Lord, I just want to say thank you, Lord. Lord, I love you. And, Lord, I adore you. Because there is none like you. My heart is for you. I adore you, Lord. I adore you, Lord. Over in 1 Peter chapter 5, I'll read a couple of scriptures there. And the word of God beginning at verse 4 says, I'm going to start at verse 2 because this is what Bishop and I do. 1 Peter chapter 5, starting at verse 2. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, serving as overseers, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be. Not greedy for money, but eager to serve, not lording over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. Young men, in the same way, be submissive to those who are older. All of you, clothe yourself with humility towards one another, because God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves before under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. And verse 7. Cast all your anxiety, cast all your cares on him, because he cares for you. Amen. The Lord gave me that reading this morning because sometimes he has to remind us of who we are in him and what we're supposed to be doing, what our behavior should be like, even in times of this. And I just know that I know that I know that I know that those who are even in the room right now, that you know that Bishop and I love each and every one of you unconditionally. EJ, if you're not here, I miss you, and I know you're not here. Every time that someone in this room is not here, we know when you're not here, and we miss you, and all we want is God's best for you. Amen? Because he's called us to do this work, and this work is not easy. I used to think it was easy getting up here. Even asked Deacon Johnson this morning, how was it last Sunday? it's not that easy. But when you've been called to do it, you do it with grace. Yes. You know, and there's no charge for it. You just get up and you just say what the Spirit of the Lord has to say, and then you move on about your business. So now what we're gonna do is we're gonna pray, and then we're gonna let the praise and worship team come forth and just minister to the Lord in song, and after that you'll hear the voice of our bishop. He will come with a word on today, and yes, he is ready to come back and to do the work of the Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Father, in your matchless and most holy name, oh God, we come before you today giving you glory, honor, and praise. For God, there is none like you, O Lord, in all the earth. Father, in the name of Jesus, there is none like you. We thank you for your Son, O God. We thank you for all that your Son gave up to do for us. And even on this day, he sits at the right hand of you, O God, interceding for us each and every day, every second, every hour, every moment of the day. Our Lord and our Savior Jesus sits right there, looking out for us, giving us guidance through the Holy Spirit. And Father, we just thank you that you care just that much for us. And on today, oh God, we pray for those who are sick and shut in. And we ask, oh God, that you extend your healing hands to each and every one right now that's in a respirator, Lord God, because of COVID, Lord God. They may be in a coma, Lord God, because of cancer, Lord. They may be in an emergency room, Lord God, because they just got hit by a car. Whatever the situation is, Lord God. If they're in a nursing home because they're aging and they might have dementia or Alzheimer's, Lord God, whatever the situation is, Lord God, we invite you, Holy Spirit, to go into that area, into that room, into that location, Lord God, and touch and heal and deliver and set the captives free, Lord God, as you said that you would do in your word by your matchless love and grace that you have for each of us. Father God, on this week, we lost another hero in the faith, Lord God. Bishop Matthew Williams. Father, we pray for his wife. We pray for his daughter. And we pray for that wonderful congregation that he led for years, Lord God. Father, we know that your will is always was done. And if you allowed him to come home to be with you, then that was your will. And his time here was well spent. And he did a great and wonderful job because he was a gentle giant in the land, Lord God. Loved by so many people, as he should be for being a shepherd leading your flock. So, Father, we thank you for all that you're going to do for the family, for the church, and for those who are mourning his loss today, Lord God. For truly, even we are mourning his loss as well, because he was a friend of my husband. And Father, we just want to say thank you for the lives of these, your people here at New Life Christian Fellowship. Touch us today, oh God. Give us the wisdom and the knowledge and the understanding that we need, Lord, to stay strong, to stay firm, to let nothing separate us from you, Lord God. Let nothing, that COVID, that cancer, not a cold, not a backache, nothing, oh God, separate us. Not finances, not the loss of a job. Nothing, oh God, let it separate us. Not a headache, oh God, not because our feet hurt, oh God, not because we can't get up this morning. Nothing separate us from your love, oh God. Let us know that at any and all times, all we need to do is just call on your name and wait for you to answer, Lord. And Father, I give you glory on this day. I give you honor, Lord. And I give you praise because you are a wonderful God. Father, I thank you for Minister Sherwood Davis, who did not think it robbery, Lord God, on last week, along with Pastor Cody, to come to New York City and to be a blessing to Bishop and myself and to those who were there. He sang his heart out, oh God. He played those keys like never before. And I know that the people of God rejoiced that were in that room, Lord. So now, Father, I pray for bountiful blessings for his life, for his children, for his wife, for his father, for his mother, for his brother, Lord. For his entire family, Lord God, not one be missed out to get the blessing for the pouring out that he did on last week, as well as Bishop Cody, Lord God. God, let no one be forgotten on this day. And if I forgot someone, Lord God, let him charge it to my head and not my heart, because my heart is pure and it wants to be there. We have such wonderful people here at New Life. Such wonderful people. Bless each and every one in this house today. And it's in the matchless name of Jesus Christ that I pray. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Amen and amen. Hallelujah.
Listen. Come on, can we give the Lord a hand of praise? Wherever you are at in your home, I don't know where you are. Amen. But just begin to just give the Holy Ghost. Give God a hand of praise for all that he has done for us. Amen. Some of us are here. Some of us are not. Amen. Some of us have lost loved ones, friends. Amen. But look at you and I. We're here today only by the grace of God. Amen. He spared our life. And for that, somebody ought to tell him thank you. That somebody ought to tell him thank you, because he didn't have to do it, but he did. We didn't deserve it, but he did anyhow. It was not of our own merit, but because of his love and kindness, he extended us to see another day. And because of that, we just want to thank him. We just want to praise him forever just want to praise. This morning, he worthy to be praised. Come on, Elena and Avery praising the Lord, so y'all better get with it this morning. Here we go, church. Come on, say it. Today, you for your love. Thank you for your power. Thank you for protection. Every hour. You know, as I drive on the road, sometimes I get a little bit impatient. Sometimes the little old me, that old wretch of sinner of me, sometimes get up. Sometimes even I react, and I don't sometimes think about what I'm doing. And because of my reaction, amen, I may say something or do something, amen, and somebody will turn that around and try to come back at me. But you know, I thank God for protecting me, even when I'm trying to protect myself.
So
listen what he did.
You
this year, people that were so close to me, but look at God, He spared my life. You want to thank God for that.
You spared my life. Oh, I just want to thank you, Lord.
Say this.
Request here.
Okay. Bless the Lord. We're going to do a song. Amen.
I've been out of church for a little while.
Indeed.
We got a few requests. Is that all right?
Yes, sir.
Y'all church folk, aren't y'all?
Yes, sir.
Everybody, am I in the right place today?
Yes, sir.
Anybody love Jesus in here?
Yeah.
All right.
Let the song minister to your spirit today. They can give me the strength like God's strength.
Come right now.
He is our strength. Strength like no other. Let the Lord use your day to come.
You are my strength.
testify.
Oh, God.
No, no, no.
and I would feel guilty and I'm trying to push it some more. But I have been waiting all week to make some noise in God's house. Sometimes even in your own house, they don't want you to make no noise. I see you laughing, Renee. I said sometimes even in your own house, they don't want you to make any noise about Jesus. And then sometimes you can come here and folk get all dignified and they don't want you to make no noise. Yeah. But I'll be doggone. Cassandra.
Yes, sir.
I said I'll be doggone. I've come here this morning.
Come on, Bishop.
To make a choice. Everything that had breath.
Praise ye the Lord.
I often wonder, like when I come in and I assume my position, because I obviously I have a position in the house of God now. I look around and I gauge the atmosphere, the temperature of the people that are here. Do they even know what they're singing? Do they even know why they're here? Do they even know who woke them up this morning? But sometimes they look like they in the La La Land. I'm thankful for this moment. Miss Lala this morning to put me in Lala Land. I came to Jesus just as I am. Amen. As you know, we've been out for a few, I don't even know how many Sundays. It's not a secret anymore. We lost our son. Tragedy struck when you least expect it. You may be seated. If you're a parent, if you're a sibling, a child, there are some calls you just don't want to get. But since you're here, let me fill you in with some truth about life. Sooner or later, you're going to be next. Yes, sir. Look at somebody. Just look at them. Look at them. Look. Sooner or later. Maybe not this week. Hopefully not the rest of this year. Maybe the next time you're at a funeral, it's a distant relative. Or just maybe it's somebody so close to you, you need help getting inside the church. I guess it was our time being next, and that call was it made me shake like I never shook before. But thank God I got Jesus. You know some things that make you shake and you won't be able to stop shaking. But I had to stop shaking, Cassandra, because I had to take care of some business. Amen. We were able to go, my wife and family, and even Minister Sherwood came down and put his life at risk. Yeah, thank you. He went down in a pandemic, you know. I mean, his job is here, his family's here. He didn't have to come to New York, and Cody didn't have to come either. But they flew up there on the hope that they could be of an asset and assistance to their dear friend. And Cassandra, I don't know, maybe 100 kids, 125. There were so many kids in that place. And I don't, Cody made all of them recite the sinner's prayer. And the Holy Ghost told me, you're gonna see all these 125 in heaven. Watch this. He said, not only these 125, but you're going to see the 125 that they touch. and the 125 did they touch. And the 125 did they touch. And the 125 did they touch. When you get up here, it's going to be a crowd for what took place in this funeral parlor on your son's death. So it was hard. It's still hard. I ask that you respect my privacy as I would respect yours. Grief is a process. I get people calling me, asking me about donuts and flat tires and things that really are irrelevant to a man or woman that's experiencing grief. Now, sometimes they don't mean any harm. They just speak before they think. I've had that problem most of my life, speaking before I think. So even as I come here, I want to make sure that my words are measured. Because once you put it out there, they can't come back. Amen. But as I say that, it was an experience unlike any other. My funeral home didn't have anything other than a podium, and Robert wasn't in any church that he went to, so I was still always his pastor. And I remember my sister said, "Well, do you need a keyboard?" Because Sherman was coming. "Yeah, we need a keyboard." Now I know she attempted to challenge my intellect by telling me the kind of piano she had. Marty, she said she had just bought a Steinway. I said, "Oh, that's nice." And she said, "Well, how much you think it costs?" I said, "Oh, knowing you, you're a judge, you make over 200 grand a year, maybe 20 grand. She said, "Boy," I said, "a Steinway." I said, "Okay, but that's a $48,000. She said, "Boy," I said, "a Steinway." Then I start Googling Steinway. I said, "Good God Almighty, $140,000 piano." So she said she had a keyboard that she would bring down. And I said, "Well, take a picture, you know, but you're talking to musicians and people. You got $140,000 piano. You might not know what I'm talking about." She might have some more. Was Casio today? Boy, want no Casio. You want no Casio, man. So I said, "I got a pro coming, so you have anything that he can play?" And I said, "Take a picture," and had a beautiful keyboard. Marty, my 75-year-old brother-in-law, packed that keyboard, packed that amplifier, big as that, packed a stool for him to sit down, and a microphone. And Cody came in and preached, and God was glorified. Amen. I want to personally take this time, me and my wife, to thank everybody that know me or know this church that reached out and said, "Thank you," sent a dime, a donut, a dollar. Believe me, it went towards saving souls. You are the recipient of maybe 1,000 souls being saved. That's an estimate that I would say would be innocent. It could be even more than that. You don't know what God is going to do. And if you had something to do with me and my wife getting to New York, then that's something that you can use when you go to God in prayer. Say, "God, I might not have been witnessing, but my seed helped Bishop go there. And he said over 125 souls got saved." So I'm asking you, reminding you that I had enough common sense to sow a seed to make a difference in somebody's life. You have that capability now, because I'm telling you, I'm sharing with you this information that you can now take as admonition to God. Now, you don't have to use it, but I'm telling you, if you live like I do, you learn to use everything you got when you ask God for something. Amen. And so, with that said, sure, what he would ask me was, "I going to come in and preach this morning?" And I said, "Well, somebody going to go. It's my job." You know, people die every day. It just might not be your son, your daughter, your mama. But life still goes on. Are we hurting beyond imagination? This morning, for instance, my neighbor's been having some challenges in their personal life. We had some tree, they did some tree cutting yesterday, and I started cleaning up my driveway, but the Holy Ghost said, look at her driveway. Her husband is not here. Before you clean your driveway, show yourself to be a good neighbor. I said, but you know, I ain't as strong as I used to be. He said, I'll give you the strength you need. Marty and I went over there this morning, and I cleaned her driveway before I cleaned mine. I said, why? And she has a son. Why did you do that? I did it because as Christians, we're to make a difference. Our light should shine. And I believe when they get up this morning, they're going to look and say, woo, who did that? And I say that to say that there's so much more we could do. And I was wondering, okay, now, God, what do I say after having experiencing something so devastating as a loss of a son? What can I say? And then the Lord gave me a word. And I'm really thankful for the prayer line. We have a prayer line that we have been utilizing since before the anniversary. And we've been praying Monday, I believe, to Friday. And a couple of days I couldn't get on after my son had died. I just was just a mess. Doesn't mean I didn't pray. I just didn't want to get on the line because I might have just lost it. But when I came back, normally on Thanksgiving Wednesday, we have off. I started giving people off because I used to be a hard taskmaster. Because I believe Jesus is coming tonight. Nobody caught that. Nobody caught that. They think he's coming. Like my old pastor, his wife said, if Jesus showed up at our house, she said, she would say, man, you got to go back. I ain't get my Bentley yet. But there's an urgency. So when we preach, we have to preach in a way that Jesus could come back tonight. Which means when I was in the Army, we had an A bag and a B bag. Those bags were meant that at any given moment, a siren could go off and a war could start, which means you had to get your behind in gear. I don't know how you living, but let me tell you, you ain't got but a few days. That's what Cody preached, man born of a woman. It's a few days and full of trouble. If nobody didn't tell you, Charity, and that text you sent me, it just woke me. But all of us in here, you ain't got but a few days. How many? I don't know. But it's not many. Don't spend your time with crazy people talking about stuff ain't got no business that's not profitable, that can't take you to where God is destining you to go. Stop spending your time with people that talk a bunch of foolishness. You need to be talking to people that are directing you in the direction of your purpose. Do I have a witness in here? There is a text that I, there's this great man of God, Archbishop Wilbur McKinley. He's deceased. You can take his name down, and I would suggest try to get some of his books or some of his tapes. He was originally born in Panama, black as a spade, spoke Spanish, spoke English, spoke Greek, and spoke Hebrew fluently. He lived in Brooklyn, pastored a church for I think about 40, 45 years before he went on with to be a Lord. He was one of the most preeminent, prominent African-American speakers in all of the state of New York. Not many people could carry Bishop McKinley's bag. Jacqueline McCullough, who was a dear friend of ours, set me up to meet him one day, and I went over there, and he fooled me, made me think he was a deacon. We went to pray, and it was him. And he sat down with me for 8 hours straight. No lunch, no tea, and all he did was pour into me. I wanted to even be my spiritual father from that point on, but you know how things go. Just didn't happen. He died a couple of years ago, but he preached the message about being made whole. Will thou be made whole? And the message is something that I've embraced. I preach it, And I preach it because it's legacy and I feel I'm a part of him. But the Lord gave me a different twist to that text today. And I hope it ministers to you. If you have a Bible, before we get there, Sherman, you got to do a couple of songs for me. We did a song in New York at my son's funeral. And Silly was playing it this morning. Precious Jesus, how I love you. How I lived. I love the Lord. Don't have to excuse me. Son. I really do. I really love the Lord. I do. I really do. So if like some Dr. Watson, our dear doctor friend who's deceased now, wonderful brother, when he saw me in my church that we were here before we started the ministry, he would always watch me. And he said to me when we got to know each other, he said he thought I was a fake. He didn't think I was real. I said, what do you mean? He said, I didn't know anybody could praise God like that. He said, when I really got to know who you were, I knew you were authentic. Let me tell you something. What you see is who I am. I do love Jesus. He said, I love him. Oh, I love him. And some mornings I gotta make my body parts love him. Sometimes my arms don't want to love him. My grandma said, you better raise your hand up. Sometimes my mind gets lax and I said, you mind, you better give him praise. Sometimes people are pulling on me not to say, leave me alone, let me give God his. But it belongs to him. A dear friend of mine, you know, I've been going through some health issues. I'd lost weight. I went down from 214 to 75, 175. I was concerned. Is anything wrong, Cat? What's going on? I had all kind of tests. Thank God they all came back negative. And watch this. I started to gain weight again. But a dear friend of mine, who I love dearly, the Right Reverend Bishop Matthew Williams, the prelate, the presiding bishop of the Church of God in Christ in Brown Memorial, is a dear friend of mine. In fact, he was born March the 13th, 1956, 1 year and 6 days after me, succumbed to COVID just the other day. We went to the same cleaners. I buried Ryan's mother, Robin, and his wife was there. And his wife said to him, boy, you better not ever preach behind Bishop. And he would say, man, I ain't gonna ever preach behind. But he was such a kind man. Cassandra, a giant in the city. And now he's gone. I say he's gone. He's down for the ages. And I'm saying to you, you don't know how long you got. You keep on acting like you got all them days. You don't know. So he's going to do a couple songs. Then I'm going to minister to you a word. Come on, son. Yes. Yeah. Precious Jesus.
Precious Jesus.
I had to tell myself that.
How I love.
After the devil took my son, I had to tell myself.
How I lift high my voice with your.
It was hard to praise God, my son dead.
Holy Spirit.
I said, Holy Spirit.
I implore.
I asked him to help me open my mouth up.
Drench my heart.
As
my lips part your grace.
I am
persuaded, Lord, to love you. I have been changed to bless your name. I am constrained by this great gospel.
Sing!
Did you get that text I sent you?
You didn't get it.
Her name is Tina Campbell. She sings a song called Destiny. Put Destiny up for a minute on YouTube. Destiny. How many feel they have destiny in them?
Oh, yes.
Come on, you're gonna act like you're alive, alive, alive. How many believe there's destiny still in them? Destiny by Tina Campbell. You find it yet? Chew it up for me. It's a real simple song. And it's in, I was playing it before I came in. Y'all just listen to it for a minute. But it's her testimony. Give me some more volume.
I've got a destination.
A destination.
In my view.
Everybody should have that.
Road may be bumpy.
It may be
bumpy. But I'm pressing through.
I
will enjoy this journey.
See, you gotta enjoy the journey, Heidi. You gotta enjoy the journey.
Stronger and wiser every day. I've got a vision.
I got a vision
and a purpose. A divine destiny.
Come on, somebody.
It may not look like.
It might not look like. But faith, is what I see.
It is the thing
I'm home for. I love this song. And no matter
how long it takes, I know God's will
shall be done. How many know His will be done? His will, Marty, is that we prosper. Come on, somebody. His will.
That I fight on.
That I fight on.
that I live.
He gave me what I needed.
How many know he gave you what you needed?
He gave
his only son.
He gave me hope and a future. He gave me.
Hey, I feel like hollering in here. That's why I've got Jesus. I have him.
Helping me
along the way. Hey, he's perfecting everything about me.
You know what that means? I'm not in the business of wasting my valuable time trying to explain to people who I am. I have destiny on my mind. If you have a Bible, go with me quickly to John chapter 5, just a few verses, 1 and 9. I thank Archbishop McKinley. I know he's looking down in heaven saying, son, do your thing, I am. Thank God for men of old. And let me share this with you, a footnote for y'all that like to talk a lot. This virus has an assignment. I said the virus has an assignment. Notice, it ain't killing kids. It ain't killing babies. It ain't killing your teenagers. It certainly ain't killing your young adults. Who's it killing? The seniors. Why would the virus target seniors? The same way Herod targeted babies that were 2 years and younger. It was to kill the king. Same way the enemy is now. He ain't changed. He wants to kill the people that you count on for advice. He wants to destroy the people that you count, that counsel you. Some of you don't get counsel from your mama. You don't get counsel from the people you should get counsel from. But there are a group of older people that every now and then you'll call and you'll take counsel from. Guess what? The attack is directed against that counsel. So that you can be left here to your own volition, your own feelings, your own attitude. And the Bible records in the book of Judges that the people that rose up did not know God, did not know his ways, and they did evil in his sight. So the goal, Mark, is to kill people like you and me off so nobody can talk to the young people like my brother over here. They just make decisions based on their feelings. And how many know you can't trust your feelings? One other thing about your feelings, for
for you Puritans in here. I'm going to tell you what the Bible says about all of our feelings. The Bible says the heart is wicked.
Yes, sir.
It's deceitfully wicked. It says that, and no one can trust it. So you know, you can trust me. You ain't just been put in the right situation. You know, we always bragging about how we the most wonderful. We ain't gonna never. You ain't been put in the right squeeze, baby. You get in the right squeeze, you'll squeeze like a pig. That's how life is. But in the text this morning, something struck me because, let's read it first. Here begins the reading of God's word. After this, there was the feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there at Jerusalem by the sheep market, a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk. That means people that lack strength. Cassandra, they could have lacked strength, physical strength. You know, you could be weak mentally, and you could be weak spiritually. So just think, there were a collection of people there, Heidi, in this location, who all suffered from some abnormality or weakness. They either were weak mentally, they were weak physically, or they were weak spiritually, and they were all waiting by this place. They were impotent folk, blind folk, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. Verse 4. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first after the troubling of the water stepped in was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. And a certain man was there which had an infirmity 38 years. And when Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case. Jesus knows how long you've been lonely. Jesus knows how long you felt unimportant and misused. Jesus knows that you have low self-esteem. Jesus knows that you don't feel good about yourself. He knows. Somebody say he knows.
He knows.
He saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case. He said to him, "Will thou be made whole?" Watch the answer. The impotent man answered him, "Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me in the pool. But while I'm coming," man, it's a mad dash. We all after the same thing. And whoever gets there first, they get the miracle. Verse 8. And Jesus said to him, watch this. He ignored his excuses. He ignored his fundamental dysfunction. Why? Because he was going to do something for him. And I'm going to tell you something. And contrary, Cassandra, to what people say, that you have to be strong spiritually. You have to be biblically sound. You have to be spiritually motivated for Jesus to do something. That's a lie. If it's in God's mind to do something for you, he'll do it. No matter if you're a crackhead, no matter if you're a whoremonger, your circumstances, your challenges don't change Jesus. Here he is 38 years waiting he's waiting on the wrong line. His intent is right, but he's on the wrong line. Anybody hear what I'm saying? And Jesus said to him, "Rise up, take up thy bed and walk." Verse 9. And immediately the man was made whole, took up his bed and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. So for the scriptures. I want to talk to you briefly for a few moments. I won't be able to do it all. On the subject, you're next. You're next. Somebody said, I'm next. Now I know the question is, I'm next at what? I don't know. I don't know what you are next at, but watch this, Cassandra. You ought to know what lines you are on. Anybody catch that? When I was in New York, Renee, we were somewhere, I don't know where I was, in Brooklyn or somewhere, and you always see these lines, whether it's for cheese or stamps or something. In New York, I'm from New York, and especially with the pandemic and with people not working, there's always lines. All my life, I waited on lines, and you're on a line right now. The problem is, you're next, and you might not know the line that you're on. Father, have your way in this place. Thank you that you speak to me, even in the midst of tragedy, death, sorrow, inexplainable pain, you still spoke to me. And I'm grateful. It reminded me of the authenticity of this walk, this call that's on my life. I thank you in the midst of death, there is still life. Life that's abundant, life that brings forth. It's edifying. Thank you that someone who is sick will get healed. Thank you this morning that someone who's at the back of the line will move to the front of the line. Thank you when this exercise is over, your name will be glorified and these your people edified. This and all other merits I beg in the matchless name of the crucified one. In Jesus' name, somebody say amen.
Amen.
All right, clap your hands if you love it. The question is, what am I next for? I don't know, but you're most definitely next for something. In life, we are always waiting for something. You can be next to graduate in the family, next to go to law school. Your father's a lawyer, his father was a lawyer, so now you're going to be next lawyer. Next to move out of your family's house. You know, you got them nexus. I can't wait because my sister moved. She joined the Army last year. My older brother went away to college and so-and-so left. I can't wait. Don't get me wrong. It's been a blast living at home for free, having my laundry done and folded in my drawers, eating my favorite food every day. It's been heavenly, but I'm 26 now and I'm the baby and I've run out of reasons to leave. I'm done with residency. And girl, they even helped me pay off my student loans. So I guess I'm next to move out of the house and live on my own. Oh my God, please pray for me. Somebody say I'm next.
I'm next.
Let me say this one thing to you right up front about being next. If you can't articulate concisely what's next in your life, then you're not living your life intentionally. I'm gonna say that again. I wrote some notes, but I don't really need the notes. If you cannot say what's next in your life, then you're not living your life intentionally. And I'm gonna help you see what I'm talking about. In the text this morning that we're reading, it's a very profound text because it illustrates a man, it illustrates Jesus. And it illustrates a situation where everybody is waiting on a particular line. They're all waiting because they was told that at some, watch this, and I can read the text carefully. The text says, watch this, that at a certain season, where is it at? Now, in verse 3 it said, these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, blind, halt, withering, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season. Now, watch this. It doesn't mean that he went down every season. So there were some seasons the angel wouldn't come. Think about it. It only says he went there a certain season. Could you imagine waiting at a doctor's office? You got gangrene and they say this ain't the season he's coming. Could you imagine waiting at a doctor's office and you're bleeding profusely and they say this ain't the season? I want y'all to hear me that these people had to wait and they had to realize that this might not be the season where they had their breakthrough. But watch this. It would not diminish how they felt about the line they were in. You got to follow me. Watch this. Here's what they knew, Marty. They knew their condition. Unlike us, we don't really know our condition. We don't really know our condition. We only surmise what our condition is based on how we feel, not based on the line that we're in. Talk to people today. Just talk to them. Ask them, what is it that they wanted to do? What did they want to be? Who they want to become? And then you ask them, and they say, articulate all the wonderful things about themselves, and then you ask them, what line are they in? Someone talk about being a singer, dancer, owning home, having real estate, but guess what? They're working at McDonald's. They're working in a field, and ain't got nothing to do with what they have been articulating, which means they're in the wrong line. How can you expect God to show up in your life if you're somewhere you ain't got no business being?
Amen.
The man wasn't religious. The man didn't even know Jesus, but the man was waiting in the right line. He had women all down with a man. Oh, I want a husband. Oh, I just want a good husband. The last husband I had, he was no good and no good. But what line are you in? What line are you in? Because from where I sit, you ain't in the line for no husband. You in the line to still sit where you sit. Because if you were in the line for a husband, baby girl, you would be going through the process of getting yourself prepared, because you realize you a woman in waiting. You ain't got time to be talking to no women gossiping all the time, because they ain't gonna get no husband. They don't want no husband. All they want to do is yak, 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 yak. You want to run with people. You want to find some women who are in the line waiting for their boo, their beau, their Boaz. Not their broke. I'll be that.
They're right there, Bishop.
I know that.
Most of them are in that line. They're broke instead of their. How do I know? They keep bringing the broke one home. I'll just leave that alone. He, watch this. The one thing that you could say about this guy was, no matter who would come and try to attempt to make him leave that line, his commitment was to that line. The challenge for Christians today is that today we believe, tomorrow we don't. Today we up, and tomorrow we down. Our faith is all over the place. We don't have the kind of commitment and the tenacity to wait no 38 years. If the Negro don't show up in a week, I'm gone. You know what that means? It means that you always had an alternate plan. See, the problem with people of God is they have not made up their mind that God is the only one that can fix my problem. God help me. See, watch this. Look, they all had a problem, but everybody couldn't fix their problem. The only place they could fix their problem was the pool at Bethesda. You got a problem with insecurity, and yet you all over the place talking to this person and that person and doing this and doing that, instead of talking to the person that can heal you from your brokenness. You suffer from low self-esteem, and you're still in the line, you're still hanging out with people that use you, mistreat you, and talk about you. You're still in the line where you're so needy and clinging to people, instead of getting in the line with the one that can make you all over again. He is able to do exceedingly. Someone's in the line to be disappointed. Next in the line to be offended better. Some of y'all women don't even realize it. Got kids and don't even realize it, because you're so busy in your feelings that you're going to be the next grandmother and don't even know it. Oh, y'all better hear me. How she get pregnant? How you know how she got pregnant? She had sex. She had sex with your head up in the clouds because you was in the wrong line while your daughter was in a line having sex. So all of a sudden now, you only 38,
and your grandmother. You didn't realize because you wasn't paying attention to your children that you was next to be a grandmother. Instead of next to being prosperous, instead of next to being educated, instead of next to being a wife, instead of next to being a preacher, instead of next to being a prophet, you somewhere being next nothing. You are next nothing. So many of us on the place, we're in a line, and when we finally get up to the front of the line, we ask the man, what's this line all about? You know what it's all about. You wasted the majority of your life. It's time for you to go home now. People die when they have nothing else to do on earth. When your purpose ends, you have no reason to be here anymore. All of us, charity, are in the line called death. You might not think you are because your hair's still growing. It ain't gray like mine. It ain't falling out. But guess what? You're still on that death line. And you cannot tell me that you're going to die after I die or I'm going to die. Nobody knows. But I can tell you this. If I examine your life for a little while, I can tell you what line you're on. Oh, wait a minute. You're broke. You're on the line of not being productive. Oh, you got a bad relationship. You're on the line where you don't know who you are. And you don't know who you're fooling with. I can look at your life. I can see you owe rent. You owe this. You owe that. It's because you're still on the wrong line of your feeling. You've been all about your feelings your whole life. It's all you've been about. Your feelings. People stat you and grab you all over the place. And the feelings are driving you places. And when you finally get there and you finally get dispossessed, evicted, you ain't got no... Why? Baby, you on the wrong line. God has been trying to minister to you. There's something in you he wants to get out of you. But you won't get in the right line. And so here this guy, in line, 38 years, in a line, the only line that hopefully would get him healed. But watch this, the odds were against him, just like you. Most Christians never experiencing God in his full totality. You know why? Because they're lazy. They're shiftless. Lazy and shiftless, and they want something for nothing. Jesus becomes our example. He becomes our example. How do you get something from God? Well, you got to believe in him. You got to trust him. So Jesus now, there was a feast going on. Everybody was preoccupied with the feast. All respectable Jews that live within a 25-mile radius had to go to three festivals. It wasn't optional. It was mandatory. Like some of y'all let your kids come to church when they feel like it. When I was growing up, there was no such thing as optional. Well, my shoe got a hole in it. Come on, give me some cardboard. I'll fix it. Give me some cardboard and a thumbtack. I'll fix it. My stockings are ripped. Well, put some grease on. You're going without stockings today. But everybody here going to church. Because you're so in your feelings, you can't raise your kids no more. They're your friends. So watch this. I want to point out a couple things about this guy. Number one, he was determined to walk. I want to ask you, what are you determined to do? I'm determined to get a new church building. I am determined to get me and my wife a new home. I am determined. I'm determined to get a new home. If she don't want it, no problem. I'm determined to get a new home. I'm determined. Watch this. I'm determined to get a new church.
Amen.
And ain't nothing going to get in my way of getting it. And that's the line that I'm on. Amen.
And guess what? I'm not letting you pull me out of this line to go over there where you're at and you don't even know what you want. So the God was determined. He was going to stand there. But his problem was this, Heidi. He thought he needed help to get his miracle. And that's the problem with most of us. He didn't need any individual to help him. He just needed to believe what God said about him. And if I could get two or three people in here this morning, you don't need nobody to help you to get in the water. You just need to know that he made water available for you to get in. You don't need nobody to take your broke down self to get no loan. All you need to know that he's the owner of the 1,000 cattle on a hilltop. You don't need no to borrow no money from no bank. What you need to know is he own all the silver and he own all the gold. And when you get to knowing who he is, change who you are. It will drastically change who you are. He told Jesus, I want to get better. I don't want to be around people that are not like him. Even though it's 38 years, he still wanted to get better. Watch your friends who have been by themselves for it. Watch what they say. Their mouths will tell you what line they're in. You better hear me. They say, come on, let's go out and get a drink. Listen to what they say. Some of them will talk about men like dogs. They ain't no good. They this and that. Listen, even though they're in the club, even though they're buying a cocktail, they're not in the line for husband. They're not. Because the words that they say give it away. When you want something, you speak well of that thing. Mm-hmm. You speak kind things. You listen, my mother used to tell me, Sister Titi and Renee, and my mother used to tell me, you get more flies with honey than you do vinegar. Yeah. So when you hear people speaking like with vinegar and gall, guess what? You know what line they're in. They're only going to receive what their mouth has pushed out. Anybody hear what I'm saying? So when Jesus asked him the question, do you want to be made whole? Jesus was asking him something that was beyond his physical. Because by now, after 38 years, it wasn't just his physical impairment. He was mentally messed up. Some of us, we ain't getting healed. We ain't getting delivered. But it's not because he can't heal us physically. We mentally messed up. Jesus told him. He said, you don't even realize it. You've been in the right line all along. Take up your bed and walk. Take up your bed. Let me tell you something. When you start having fellowship with Jesus, there's a whole lot of things you're going to be able to do that you couldn't do before. Nobody's talking back to me in here. Sure, what I need some preaching music in there. Y'all make me preaching. Hey, turn that hand. Listen. When you meet Jesus, the stuff that you used to couldn't do, you'll start being able to do it now. And if some man treated you bad, and if some man made you some piece of property, beat you and took advantage of you, and you lost all self-respect, and you gave him everything. Well, guess what? When you meet Jesus, Jesus has the ability to bring restoration to your life. Do I have a witness in here? The Bible records in the book of John chapter 4, when he met that woman at the well, he was there for one purpose only, and that was to bring her restoration. He realized that she had had five husbands already and that she had been messed up and messed over. He realized that her theology was messed up, and Jesus came by. He stopped by because he realized that she was going to be an instrument in the hand of God to win souls to the kingdom. So he had to take some time to explain to this woman who he really was. He said, girl, go get me some water. She said, let me tell you something. If the truth be told, Samaritans and Jews ain't got no doings with each other. And Jesus said, woman, if you know who I was and who it was that asked you for some water, you would have put a demand on me and I would have given you something. Because what you don't realize, it's midday. You're stuck to the well because you didn't want nobody to see you. But I brought you here because I want to bring you to the front of the line. Do I have anybody here this morning that God is calling you to the front of the line to bless you, to deliver you, to heal you, to prosper you, to empower you? Somebody up!
Yeah. Oh yeah. She didn't know it was her day. Because sometimes when you mess up and you get out there, it's always a line in front of you. But when you're doing business with God and God says your time, somewhere between sunrise and sunset, He'll remove all of the hindrances. He'll remove all of the obstacles. He'll take that mountain and move it. And when you wake up in the morning, you'll have a clear path. I'm talking about God, the great emancipator, the great liberator, the great I am, my Father, your Father, who is able. I said He's able. This morning, I've come to ask somebody, you're next. Forgive me, not ask the question, but remind you, you're next. Next for what? Next for your new house. Next to get a wife. Next to get a husband. Y'all ain't talking back to me. I need somebody. I want somebody that got enough faith in them to stand up, open up their mouths, and say, I was next to be broke. I might as well be next to be rich. I was next to lose a child. But I'm next to go to the mountaintop. See ya. See ya. Say I'm next for promotion. I'm next for breakthrough. I'm next. I'm next. Up next, somebody holler. Twenty-two years in ministry. And because the devil thought he took my son, that I wouldn't be next, I'm still next. I declare I'm next. New building, paid off. New house, mortgage that I could afford. If somebody ain't mad with me, but can shout with me, give God some praise. Say yeah, say yeah, say yeah. Danny, you're next. Next for your miracle. Next for your new job. Next for your new house. Next for your money. Yeah! 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 Up next. Watch this. And when you're next, ain't nothing the devil can do but clap his hands. Ain't nothing the devil can do but said, I knew you was gonna make it. He's a liar and the truth ain't in him. If God raised you up, can't no devil pull you back down. Now if you're next for your miracle for the next 10 seconds, give God a crazy praise for 10 seconds. Hallelujah! 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 Yeah! Yeah! the wrong line. You've been in the wrong line. The reason your life, the reason why, Heidi, most of the people who come to church never experience the power of God, because they don't come in all the way. They come in with one foot in and one foot out. I dare you to get both feet in. If you get both feet in, you'll be on the right line and God will bless you. November the 5th, we didn't know it, but Robert Jr. was on the line that had the glory. He didn't have time to check with us, but when I found out he was gone, I realized what line he was on, and God told me he gonna come back, but one day I'll be on that line to see him. Somebody holler for me! Get out of lines that have been there for a long time, or people that lack patience and people that lack foresight. Because if you've been sowing and working in a particular area, only fools get out of line. Because once you get a line, you lose your place. Have you ever been on the phone with a bank and you just couldn't get off the line? They tell you, listen, all you got to do is just give us your number, we'll call you back. And guess what? They never call back. Listen, when God has you, that's why when you hear people talking about, I'm going here, I'm going there. Listen, what they're telling you is they don't really care what line they're on. I care what line I'm on. Because guess what? I know one day the death line is going to be there. See, when people don't care what line they're on, guess what? Death going to catch them like a thief in the night. Don't let it catch you. You stay on the lines that you want to receive from. You want to be blessed? Stay on the blessed line. Don't get on the cursed line. You want to hear God's voice? Stay in a place where you can commune with Him. Stay on that line. Stay on the prayer line. Don't stay on the strife line. Don't stay on the gossiping line. Get off of those lines and identify people that are on them and keep your distance from them. Why? Because they'll corrupt your hard drive. And listen, in this hour that we're living in, we need to hear God. We need to hear God's voice. When I was home, the Lord wanted to speak to me and put a whole lot of money in my pocket. But I didn't hear Him. Only because I had so much going on and too many people pulling on me. I mean it. I would have came back here with a bucket loads of money with my, because God gave it to me, but I wasn't sensitive to His voice. Because too many people pulling on me, calling me, asking me questions when I need God to speak to me. So I tell y'all, keep people at a distance. Not that you don't love them. Let them know they can't, they cannot be God in your life. I'm telling you, JC, God wanted to put so much money. My wife could tell you, I'm not just saying this, but guess what? I couldn't hear Him. So when I got back, I spoke to a prophet. I had a dream. My dog got away. And you know, we crazy about our animal. When we get away, he'll run and never come back. I was weeping, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, my older brother, who's dead, been dead for 12 years, came out the woods with my dog. Smiled and said, he said these words to me, "You ain't lost nothing, it's coming back." Money! It's coming back. You under the sound of my voice today, I prophesy to you, Lennon, it's coming back. The things that you want, things that have been so hard for you to get your, I'm telling you, they're coming back. This time next year, all those things that you have been without, I prophesy in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, you're going to have them. You won't need the assistance that you need now, this time next year. Why? You're in the right line. You're in the right line. You stay in that line, Lenny. Don't get out that line, Lenny. He's going to bless you. I hear the Lord saying, so be patient. God's going to do it. God's going to do it. Those 10 virgins, one, 5 were wise and 5 were unwise. This is the time to be wise. Don't get out of this church. Don't leave this line unless God tells you. Because He tells you, then you do what He says. But if He says stay, listen, you stay. Because listen, we're going to build a school. We're going to have a daycare. It's going to be here. Why? I'm in the line. I'm in the line. Celeste, your relationship with God has to take on a new dimension. The enemy is preventing you from getting into that school. You have to press your way, push like you never did before. And when you do that, God said He'll open up the door for you. It can't be your mother, can't be your grandmother, it got to be you. If you do it, if you cry out, He said you're next in line to be accepted to one of the prestigious physical therapy programs in the country, even though you've been denied. If you press your way into me, I'll do things that nobody can know. He said, I'll show you signs and wonders, saith the Lord. How many believe? How many believe the Lord in this place? And you tell your brother, because he had the, don't even know, because he sowed that seed. You tell him, ask God for whatever He wants. God's going to release it. And Kiki, because you prayed, sent me prayer when I didn't even want to hear nobody's voice. And you prayed, may the Lord bless you financially. May the Lord bless your territory. May He enlarge your borders. All of those that pray for me, may the Lord bless you, enrich you, empower you in the matchless name of the Savior. Somebody give God a big amen in this place. Amen. I'm rich. rich already. Somebody say the bishop is rich already. This church is going to grow to over 250 people next year. I said it. I said it. I said it. I said it. Over 250. Watch this year. We're going to have a space problem next year. Not a people problem. We're going to have no space. Let's collect an offering today. Amen. I'm excited. I know, devil, you thought because you took my son, you took my zeal. No, you didn't take my zeal. Like David said, you might have took my son, but I'm going to see him one day. Hey, I'm going to see him one day. I'm going to see my boy.
Yeah.
y'all don't know is the breakthrough comes in the overflow. Is when you're still giving God praise, that's when he starts releasing stuff. By the time you get back home, everything you've been asking God for is already there. The state of Georgia gonna do on the 5th of January when them two Democrats win the Senate seats, they gonna be shout down there. Devil, you heard me? Devil, did you hear me? What you meant for evil by taking Robert Jr. Robert, don't turn it around. That's turning it around for our boy. It hasn't been a day this week that I have not talked to both of all of my kids. That's something I didn't do all the time. So what you thought you did, you didn't win anything.
Amen.
Thanks be unto God.
Amen.
Always causes us to trouble. I'm going to leave you with this footnote. There always has to be a first. Somebody first to lose their mother. Somebody first to lose their house. Somebody first to lose their wife, their father. So that you can see how people go through the process of grieving. God will let you get a long distance view of it so that you can get yourself prepared, because guess what? Eventually, you're next. Don't be afraid about being next. Embrace being next, just like if you were getting $1 million. Because all things work together for good. Watch this. To them that love God, and to those that are called according to his purpose. And let me tell you something. God loves us just that much. We're his children. He's the father of the universe. But watch this. On a more personal note, he's father to believers. You have to understand that. He's father to the universe, and but his real father to believers.
You know what that means? That if he's my daddy, he cares about me. My rising and my lying down. I want you to believe everything that God is and everything that God says. And if you tap into that and begin to adjust your prayer life, just like this young woman, you'll begin to cry. And your prayer life will take on a new dimension. You might not get the pot of gold the first time, but I tell you, your heart will be so full of joy and empowerment that you can't wait till you get back to that room again. God will always take care of his own. Stretch your hands towards the offering basket. Father, we thank you. Thank you for Celeste. Even though I lost a son, I still have daughters. When I first met her, she was no more than 7. So you can't take anything from me, devil. And when you take God, give back more.
Yes.
Give back seed to the sower and bread to the eater. Bless these your people that had the nerve to come out in the pandemic. I mean, bless them in a special way. Money, finances, joy, relationships, promotions on their job. God, give them massage. Somebody's feet is hurting. Let them go get their feet massaged. Whatever it is, their back, whatever it is, right now, I pray you give them opportunity to have that area ministered to, because they came here today. In Jesus' name, somebody say amen. Let's have our benediction. Let's stand. Yes. And 16. Those are special dates. She's a young woman now. They both are, really. So we got to keep our eyes on them and keep praying for them.
That's right.
Even though you're 16, you might feel like you're 20, stay 16. Enjoy your youth. Father, in the master's name of Jesus Christ, we anoint her. We anoint her with the gift of moderation, with the gift of stability, with the gift, dear God, of chastity. We release an anointing upon their lives that they might be sponges when it comes to English and mathematics and science, that they might be sponges when it comes to thy word, that they might grow up like cedar. They might grow up like Lebanon trees. I release an anointing upon them that they might be blessed. Blessed and favored. I thank you for their lives. Protect them, God. Protect them. I release the anointing. May the blood cover and protect them in Jesus' name. Somebody say amen. Somebody say happy birthday. Remember, always sanitize. Keep your hands clean. Make sure I had to learn, because I used to put my hands in my face all the time. I sanitize. I'm a sanitizing demon now, bro. I'm always doing this. Washing my hands, washing this. I'm trying to make sure I don't get no COVID. Amen. Amen. How many glad they came to the house of the Lord today? I said, how many glad? Somebody say, I'm next for my miracle. Somebody say, I'm next for my resources, my prosperity. Somebody say, I'm next for God's blessing. Somebody say, I'm next for everything that God has for me. Father, I came here today and I told them, just like you gave it to me, we're next. We're next to some things we don't even know we're next to. But what we really want to be next to, we want to be next in line to all that you have ordained for our lives. We want to move into the next realm of our purpose. We want to move in the next dimension of this anointing. We want to move, God, so that you can have your way and you can be glorified. As we leave this place but never your presence, we're mindful of our imperfections. We pray for this city. We pray for this state. We pray for this nation. We pray for the peaceful transfer of power. We pray, God, for this state, this nation to unify. Now unto him who's able to keep each of us from falling. He alone has the power to present each of us faultless in the presence of his glory with exceeding joy.
To the only wise God, our Savior, to him be majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forevermore. And may the fellowship of the Holy Spirit remind you of these words. You might not want to be next at some things, but you are next. Take that thought to heart and be blessed. God bless you. We love you. Make sure you give somebody an imaginary God bless you hug before you leave. We love you.